Hey everyone, Devin here from American Aquarium Products with Southern Oregon Aquarium and Pond. Thank you for tuning in. We're on site at location here to learn about how to do our spring care, getting our pond ready for the season. So stay tuned, don't change the channel. Take a look at these tips for a successful pond all season long.
Okay, so while looking at this beautiful pond that we have here as an example, the first thing we want to think about is water circulation. A general rule of thumb is we want somewhere between 50 and 200 gallons per hour per 100 gallons. This is a very generic rule. This also considers every pump that's being used in the pond, including aerators. Aerators are a great tool that take bubbles from an air stone down at the bottom of the pond and lift water up and lift air up, creating a pull, drawing debris from the bottom of the pond up and lifting it so they can be drawn to a pump filter and out of the pond. And then these bubbles coming from the aerator also are breaking water tension, expanding the surface area of the pond, having greater gas exchange for oxygen to enter the pond. Oxygen is key for helping break down your buildup in the pond and also providing the plants, fish, with essentials for a healthy life. Next is good filtration. Good filtration is key to a healthy pond. And when I'm saying filtration, not only mechanical, but more importantly is biological. Biological is going to be what keeps the pond clear. A good biological filtration system is going to be what sets apart an average pond from a real spectacular clear pond. The best way to do this, along with other forms of mechanical filtration, is using a bog plant, or sometimes referred to as a wetland filter. This is going to draw water through a very packed biological zone in the pond, usually using some type of rock where bacteria can live, and also having plant roots in this rock area to allow those roots to consume the waste. Drawing water through these zones makes for a very efficient, a very large biological filter. Understanding how the nitrogen cycle works when trying to figure out your filtration is key. When we have debris that falls into the pond, leaves, pine needles, waste, it all goes through the nitrogen cycle. Ammonia, which is from the waste, is converted into nitrite, which is then converted into nitrate, which is then going to either be removed from a water change or consumed by an organism like bacteria or roots. We want a strong biological filter that's going to consume this ammonia all the way through to also nitrate. Keeping this N nitrate low is important just to keep it in check and in maintenance, while not necessarily toxic by itself. Allowing for too high of a buildup will lead to these more unhealthy water conditions and poor health for the livestock. Smaller ponds, and really up to larger ponds, but considering, can have, say, a pump in the pond with a fountain head diverted off to a canister filter, then after the canister filter to a UV, and then to a veggie wetland filter. For a larger pond, considering just a large biological wetland filter really is what's going to make a best filtration system for these large ponds. Also consider a larger UV sterilizer. American Aquarium supports the TMC brand from the UK because they have a long dwell time, but also a narrower chamber that keeps the water right next to the UV lamp. If you're going to consider sterilization, which is best for fish and just overall health of the pond, it's also what's going to help if something happens to your biological filter or it's an extra hot day. the sterilizer is going to be best for clarification. But what American Aquarium recommends is having an actual sterilizer that's going to protect from bacteria, disease, all the way up to virus protection. Around this springtime, pond cleaning becomes very important. We want to remove dying debris, fallen leaves, fallen pine needles, as much mulm at the bottom as we can to set us up to have the least amount of bio load in the pond, getting us ready for the hot season. We want to have nitrates that are around or below 50 ppm, phosphates that are at or lower than 1 ppm, a pH of 50 to 90 ppm, and a GH of 150 ppm. The pH of this range that was just specified is best to make sure that we do not have a swinging pH that can happen from acid, mulm buildup in the pond. Having a solid pH is going to be best for koi and goldfish health long term. The swinging pH is in a very harsh, more harsh than really any other parameter swing. And so having a solid pH, which is an alkalinity buffer in the pond, is best. This can be done with having harder water right out of the tap or an additive of an alkaline buffer and managing it throughout the season. GH is important to have, not just so we can have a higher general hardness, but it is an indication of how much electrolytes are in the water. We can have a higher GH out of our tap or well water, but we don't necessarily know how much electrolytes, how electrically charged the water is. So best is to provide these electrolytes, and for a pond, it's highly recommended to use a mineral block that slowly dissolves. We can see from actual experiments that these extra electrolyte minerals combat oxidative stress, which is acid buildup in the pond. Koi and goldfish, we want to make sure that we're giving a quality diet. This is going to be best beneficial for growth, breeding, color enhancement, and really when you get a good quality food, it's going to limit the nitrogen waste that is being produced because more is being digested from the fish than being just passed from the fish. We want a high protein aquatic-based diet. It's aquatic-based as in the proteins that are being used for these herbivore fish are actually plant proteins that are aquatic, not necessarily a land plant, a terrestrial plant. Cereal is commonly said to be fed to fish, and to a degree it can be towards the beginning of the season, helping fats being moved, just moving the digestive tract, but really it's just using for the roughage of the cereal to help the digestive tract start to move, but it's not something that needs to be done long term. The general rule of thumb is colder weather, 50 degrees or below, about 60 degrees we can consider feeding every other day. And at about 70 degrees, this is when we start feeding the fish daily. In addition to boosting immunity, feeding spirulina is a good extra tool, even more so if there are baby fry. During this springtime, now is a good time to consider repairs to liner, plumbing, pump, make sure to check impellers, make sure to check for leaks, make sure to check for blockages. Repair has to be done to a leaky liner, make sure to use a PVC material liner with a 45 millimeter thickness. If your pond is a spring-fed pond, make sure to take a look at the article in the description for how to manage these best. Remember that koi can get up to about 3 feet long, so we want to have one koi for about 200 gallons. Goldfish can get to about a foot and a half. Sometimes they've been reported to get almost 2 feet long. Make sure we're checking out for pond predators. As the season warms up, there's going to be new critters coming along. Blue heron, raccoon. There's devices that spray when the predator comes along as a motion sensor. Having a net, or at least a place where the fish can go deeper, finding protection from these critters is a good idea. When we're growing our pond plants, say lilies, a good rule of thumb is to have about 70% of the surface covered for that protection. For fry, it's best to have planted areas where they can swim, hide, allow them to really grow out and feel protected in these real dense planted areas. Now is also the time to start fertilizing plants, making sure they come in nice and thick and actually flower. We need lots of flowers all season long. If you're going to be adding new fish to the pond, consider acclimating them and quarantining them just like we would in an aquarium, but it's so much easier to treat from a quarantine system to either have to get the fish out of the pond or treating the whole pond with healthy fish. Remember that all fish, when fish get sick, it comes down to immunity. This could be genetics, but also just if the fish is being warm with their immunity. So we want to keep the immunity boosted of all fish from, most importantly, mineralization and sterilization, and then quality food. And after that, it's going to be water maintenance.
All right, gang, I hope that was helpful for you. If you have any questions, please ask, of course. And remember to like, subscribe, share with your friends. And I appreciate you guys. I hope you know that. Tune in next time for another informational video. Bye.